is everyone today? Good. Let me wish you a Merry Christmas. It is August, and you know what happens in this church in August? We start practicing for a Christmas cantata. So, let me encourage those of you that might not sing with us on a regular basis, but you have a little interest in coming and singing with us in the cantata. We'd love to have you. We are going to start Tuesday night at 6 o'clock with a fellowship meal, and then Wednesday night the rehearsals will start at 7:45 to 8:30. So we would love to have you. Each year we have 8 or 10 folks that join us for that special activity, which will be on over in December. But hope that some of you will come and sing with us. Thank you.
And I'm fortunate because they'll let me join them for the meal, but they never asked me to sing. I don't know why. It's just that way, I guess. But a couple of other announcements. I just was reminded our care ministry is doing a wheelchair ramp next Saturday morning, and it's going to be a rather large one, so they could use some help. If you are available and can be here at 7 a.m., y'all going to meet at the church, aren't you, Paul, and leave from here, and they would be glad to help you with putting together that ramp and getting it ready. Also, remember, 2 weeks ago, we opened the registration for the cornhole tournament. I know all of you have invited your one, and you all have a partner. But if you haven't, another stage of it opens today. And so it's open to everybody. So let's fill it up. Remember, this kind of like best description I would use it is sort of a pre-tailgate party. We're going to be at the church on August the 24th from 6 to 8. We're going to have all kinds of food and stuff like that. So if you have a chance, get you a partner, come play cornhole. If you don't play cornhole, get you somebody and just come on, and we'll have a good time anyway as we fellowship together and enjoy our time with one another. Now, I want you to just stop for 1 second, take a deep breath, and join me in a word of prayer. Lord, we breathe in this moment, we breathe in your glorious presence that is here to meet us. Now open our hearts, open our eyes, open our ears, and open our lives to you. And prepare us for the plans that you have for us in this time of worship. Amen.
to see each of you. Take your hymnals. We turn to hymn number 44, Great is Thy Faithfulness. We sing all stanzas. May we stand as we sing.
Please remain standing and join with me in our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. It will be on the screens behind me. If we ever get it up there. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Now and ever shall.
may be seated. Before we bow our heads for a moment of prayer, I'd like to ask you to please remember Everett, Nix, and Kathy. I know you've seen all the emails this week, but Everett is doing much better. Hopefully going to be moved to a regular room by the end of the day or tomorrow. But please continue to pray for he and Kathy as they move through this process, because there will be a long process of recovery. Also, Betty Tucker is in the hospital in DCH again, so pray for her and Leon as she tries to battle pneumonia. And remember Janice Brazil as she recovers at rehab. So let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Lord, we are thankful for this time that we have to gather in this place, to lift our voices in song and to open our hearts in worship to you. And Lord, we are thankful because you are faithful. You are not only here every week, but you are with us each and every moment of life. You are there to offer us encouragement, and you are there to offer us strength, and you are there to lift us up when we are weak, and you are there to carry us forward when we can't move anymore on our own. And you showed us the extent of your love in your Son Jesus, his willingness to step down from heaven to come and to dwell among us and to connect with us by doing life with us right in the middle of where we were. He didn't say, change your ways. He just said, let me come and experience life with you, and let me show you how to live life to the fullest. Now I pray that you'll pour your Holy Spirit out upon us gathered here this morning, that you will transform our hearts, that you will transform our minds, that you will open our eyes and our ears to your call in our lives, and that you will send us forth into the world so that we can share the wonders of your grace and your mercy with our neighbors, with our friends, and with our brothers and sisters. And Lord, we do come to you. But as we move into your presence, we also recognize how much we fall short of your glory. So we ask you to forgive us for our sins. But encourage us by letting each of us hear you whisper in our ears, my child, you are forgiven. Now create a heart within us that offers that same measure of forgiveness to our brothers and sisters. And we lift up to you those we have called, but all of those sick that we name in our heart in this moment. And Lord, we pray for those that need healing, we pray that you will touch them with your healing touch. For those that need guidance, we pray that you'll give them direction. For those that need strength, we pray that you will cover them with your peace. And as always, we pray for the leaders of our country, the leaders of our state, the leaders of our community, the leaders of this church. Lord, we pray this and we ask this in the name of your Son Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
When wrong will be made right, and justice will shine like the sun. That day is coming, when righteousness will reign, and darkness will be chained for good. So we watch and wait for that day, when heaven's light will break the sky eyes, and we will see the truth for blinds, and this world's dark night is finally through. When love will wipe away our tears, forever banish every fear, and Jesus will make all things new. That day is coming, the streams of mercy flow, and all the wounds we've known are healed. That day is coming, glory is unleashed, and the promise we believe we'll see. So we watch and wait for that day, when heaven's light will break the skies, and we will see the truth from lies, and this world's dark night is finally through. When love will wipe away our tears, forever banish every fear, and Jesus will make all things new. That day is coming. That day is coming.
Singing. Thank you so much, choir, for leading us in worship this morning. I would tell you to take your hymnals, but the next hymn we're going to sing is not in the hymn book. So if you'll follow along on the screens, we stand together as we sing, Are Ye Able?
Bow your heads with me for a moment of prayer. Our gracious and loving God, we are thankful that we have this opportunity to worship you with our tithes and our offerings. We pray that you will bless these gifts, that you will use them for your glory and for your honor. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Back a month or so ago, when Bo and Jason started developing this series on the One, I told Bo, I said, well, one of the Sundays I could sing an old song that probably a half a dozen folks in this congregation have never heard. And sure enough, I asked the choir Wednesday night, how many of you know the 99? About two hands went up, and I'm sure there wasn't that many more that went up this morning. But this is an old song written many, many years ago, and it's very appropriate for this theme. One thing I'd like to point out, although we're talking about a shepherd with his sheep, basically what this song is about is the Lord and all of the followers that he's trying to bring into the fold, the 90 and 9.
Thank you. 99 that safely lay in the shelter of the fold. But one was out on the hills far away, far off from the gates of gold. Away on the mountains, wild and bare, away from the tender shepherd's care, away from the tender shepherd's care. Lord, thou hast for thy 99, are they not enough for thee? But the shepherd made answer, this of mine has wandered away from me. And although the road be rough and steep, I go to the shepherd to find my sheep. I go to the desert to find my sheep. And all through the mountains, thunder riven, and up from the rocky steep, there arose a glad cry to the gate of heaven, rejoice, I have found my sheep. And the angels echoed around the throne, rejoice, for the Lord brings back his own. Rejoice, for the Lord brings back his own.
Thank you, Ronnie. You know, last week, over 200 of you. Now, I did warn everybody that I'm the one that counted those, and that's more fingers and toes than I have. So, but over 200 of you signed and said, hey, we're going to set our hearts to go to God. And part of this one series is an introduction of the new vision that our vision group came in, the board approved. And so I wanted you to know, because to set our heart to go with God is saying we're going to do life together with God and with each other. And I wanted us to read that vision statement. It's on the front of the bulletin, but it's also going to be on the screens here for you. Read this together. I'm warning you because I started it with the early service and nobody but me was talking. But it's going to be up here on the screen. And then you can read that with me. Doing life together by putting aside ourselves for the sake of others, so we become who God made us to be. You know, the doing life together part's the easy one. The second stage, that by putting aside ourselves for the sake of others, I hate to warn you, that's the hard part. You know, but if we're going to strive to be who God called us to be, if we're going to try to develop a Christ-like mind, because a Christ-like mind prioritizes the one. How many of you have ever been on the outside looking in? I mean, you know, have you ever been to a party where everybody knew, laughed at the inside joke, and you had not a clue what they were talking about? Or maybe you've been in a group, you know. Back in February, Chris and I went with her two sisters and brother and his wife to St. Kitts to spend a week. And about Wednesday, now you've got to know this background. All of them grew up in Heflin. all of them but Chris still live in Heflin. So they were talking about all these people. And about Wednesday, I had heard enough about all these people that I didn't know and didn't care and was never going to meet. And so one day I just kind of got up and slipped away from the table while they were talking, went downstairs, and Chris came down a little while. She said, "What are you doing down here? Why are you not up there with us?" I said, "Because I'm tired of hearing about everybody I don't know, and I don't know the punchline on all this." You know, I think we all felt like an outsider. Like we're standing at the window looking in. I wonder if you've ever felt that way in church. You know, several years ago, I was associated at Anniston, and I was running late for Wednesday night supper, so I kind of shot through the alley trying to cut around and get in there. And when I started down the alley, I ran into a guy that was a homeless guy that was off the street, and he said, "Hey, would you give me $10 for supper?" I said, "Nope. Won't give you $10 for supper, but I'll tell you what I'll do. I will buy you supper, and I will sit down and have supper with you. Just come on and go with me." So I took him around, and we walked into the fellowship hall where we gathered for Wednesday night meals, and we walked from the door to the line, the serving line, and that was the longest walk I've ever made in my life. I felt like I was a leper with a bell around my neck, and everybody was looking at us like, "Well, wait a minute now, what are you doing with this person?" And it was, you know, we didn't have to worry about finding a seat. That's the best thing. We just sat down where we wanted, and everybody cleared. It looked like a covey of quail going away. But you know, my guess is we have all experienced what it felt like. To be on the outside looking in. Obviously, the Pharisees and scribes had not figured that out. As a matter of fact, they had spent their whole lives as insiders. They are good church people of the day. They lived their lives by the law of Moses. They strive daily to keep every rule and every regulation, and they were and are God's chosen people. And they were careful to let you know it. They had built a barrier between themselves and the world. And actually, they had a name for all of us, those on the outside who didn't follow the law and didn't follow all the rules and regulations. They were called the people of the land. You know, they were forbidden to marry or to give in marriage anyone in their family to someone who was a person of the land. They were forbidden to have a guest or be a guest of a person of the land. They could not do business, no business dealings with people of the land. As a matter of fact, they saw the people of the land not as people, but as sinners not worthy of God's steadfast love. And all of a sudden, the tables are turned. Jesus, the itinerant preacher who has drawn such a crowd, is not sitting amongst the Pharisees and the scribes and talking and discussing and refining the law of Moses, but he's hanging out with the people of the land, common people, people with questionable reputations, people on the fringe of life. He's investing in their lives. He's sharing meals with them. He's laughing and connecting with people that were on the outside. And for the first time in their lives, the Pharisees feel like Wilson. Anybody remember the old show Home Improvement with Tim Allen? Wilson, the guy that was always looking over the fence, for the first time in their lives, they were looking over that barrier that they had built, and they didn't like it. As a matter of fact, you may say, "Well, how do you know they didn't like it?" If you will turn with me to the Gospel of Luke, the 15th chapter, I'll read you the first couple of verses of this chapter. "Now all the tax collectors and sinners coming near to listen to him, and the Pharisees and scribes were standing on their tiptoes looking down over their barrier at Jesus and were, and were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. You know, this 15th chapter in the Gospel of Luke, by some, is considered the gospel, actually within the gospel. You know, on the surface, they seem like they're the same, but if you really start to dig within them, you begin to see a different understanding of God and his relationship to all of God's creation. You know, the lost sheep, we all know that story, don't we? Ronnie just sang it to you, the 99 leaving behind. What you've got to understand, in Jesus' day, most people didn't have just one flock and shepherds for that flock. The flock was a community flock. Everyone in town would kind of put their sheep together because, see, there's problems. And if you've ever been to the Holy Land, you understand this. There's not a lot of space over there. So there were no barbed wire fences. There were no terrace roads. There were no, you know, stuff separating. They just let the sheep kind of graze and feed wherever they were. And so it was common that all the sheep from the whole community were put into one flock and the shepherds watched over them. But even more, the shepherds not only watched over them, the shepherds had to risk their lives to protect the sheep. The shepherds were expert trackers. Because, see, it was common for one of the sheep to kind of just aimlessly wander away and go to another place. So the shepherd's job was to go out and to find the sheep and to bring the sheep back if he could. And if he couldn't find the sheep alive and bring it back, he was to bring back the fleece, the wool, and prove, here's what happened to the sheep. So you've got to understand that in Jesus' story, when there is one sheep missing, nobody knows whose sheep it is. And when the shepherd goes away, the whole community would gather at that moment, and they were waiting anxiously for the arrival of the shepherd with news about the sheep. And you could almost see him coming as he had found the sheep and had it up on his shoulders. And you could feel that sort of community exhale of he found our sheep. Our sheep is okay. And you could feel the excitement and the joy of each of those in that community, because now they were celebrating that what was lost is now found. And in that moment, they understood what it was like to celebrate. But what Jesus wants you to see is a different picture of God. And Jesus draws a clear one here, that God is a God who knows the risk and is willing to risk it all for the one, for one of us that may have wandered away. And when the lost is found, not only does God rejoice, but all the angels in heaven join with him, and they are filled with joy. And then Jesus says there was a woman who lost a coin. You know, there are two possibilities here. The coin was probably worth a value of 4p, which is more than one day's wages. So the one idea could be that she lost this coin. And you know, in ancient Israel, in those times, families didn't live paycheck to paycheck. They live day to day, moment to moment, and just any little thing could cause the whole family to perish. So if you lost over a day's wages, you can imagine the excitement that she would have trying to find that. But then I learned something new. There's a second option it could be. Women, actually, they started as young girls, would begin to gather and save and scrimp to buy or purchase 10 coins. 10 coins which were connected together by a wire, and those coins made a crown that would go on her head. So in essence, when she was married, that crown would symbol her marriage. So she had dreamed and hoped all of her life for that moment. Ladies, imagine this. If all of a sudden you walked in and you noticed the diamond in your wedding ring, or your wedding ring in itself, was gone. Now, you add into this factor, their houses weren't all the hardwood and all this stuff that we have, or whatever the stuff all is on the floor. They were made basically of dirt and of straw. So you imagine your diamond ring falling down in the dirt and the straw. It's kind of like searching for a needle in a haystack. She is sweeping around, moving around, just praying with every push of the broom that there'll be a small glint of the coin and that coin in that moment. And when she finds it, not only does she celebrate, she calls everyone in the neighborhood and says, "You know what? Now I am set free. I now am reminded of who I am. Come and join with me in this moment." See, in this parable, in this particular parable, Jesus is turning the Pharisees' world upside down. No Pharisee has ever dreamed of a God who would search for someone. Now, they would agree that you could return to God and find forgiveness, but they would have never thought of God actively seeking the one that was lost. And then my favorite parable, the parable of the two sons. You notice I said two sons, not one. We always focus on the prodigal. You know the prodigal, you know that story where he walked in and said, "Hey, Dad, you won't die, and I'm tired of waiting on you to die, so go ahead and give me my inheritance, and I'm going to go off into a foreign land, and I'm going to have a good time." And he did. He took his inheritance. He went away. He probably was a third of that, and he went away, had a fun, had great time till a famine came, and then he realized, he came to himself, the scripture says, and he returned home. But then you have the older brother, the oldest brother. Those of us that are the oldest in our families can understand, especially if we have younger baby brothers. You know, that older brother who had always been there, had gone out in the field every day, had done what his father asked. And yet when his brother comes home and he finds out his father has killed the fatted calf and is having a celebration, he is so angry, he refuses to go into the house. "This son of yours, Dad, who was dead, has returned and you've done this?" But you know what Jesus wants us to see is not the two sons. Because we each can relate to the sons. What Jesus wants us to see is the Father. The father who's walked out every day since the youngest left, and he stood on the porch and he strained his eyes looking up on the horizon, just praying and hoping that his son would come to himself and come home. The father that when he saw him, you know, no self-respecting Jewish man would run. This father ran as fast as he could out to his son and greeted him with open arms. And then the older son, who was angry and was outside refusing to come in, the older son, the father did what? He went out to him, reached out to him, and invited him in as well. William Barclay, in his commentary on Luke 15, says this: "We must finally note that these three parables are not simply three ways of stating the same thing. There is difference. The sheep went lost through sheer foolishness. It did not think, and many people would escape sin if they would stop for a minute and think. The coin was lost at no fault to its own, Many a person has been led astray, and God will not hold them guiltless who has taught another to sin. And the son deliberately chose to be lost, to turn his back on his father. He said the love of God can defeat the foolishness of man, the seduction of tempting voices, and even the deliberate rebellion of the heart. So how do we live this way? How do we live this Luke 15 way? I think if you turn to our second scripture for the morning, Philippians 2, you'll see. Because in Philippians 2, I think Paul lays out a way for us to live life through the eyes of Luke 15. The first is leave behind what is comfortable. Listen to what Paul says. But speaking of Jesus, emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. See, you imagine, we spend our whole lives trying to get to heaven. Jesus made a choice to step down out of heaven, where he was in the presence of God, sitting at his right hand, with everybody that has gone before us. They are celebrating God's glory. And Jesus said, no, I'm going to give this up. I'm going to step down from heaven. I am going to earth, and I am going to put on flesh and dwell amongst these people. Not, and John says it, he didn't send his son in the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. So we all know John 3:16, but a lot of us don't know John 3:17. But I love the way Paul puts it. God proves his love towards us in that, listen, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Do you hear it? Jesus didn't say, you know, if y'all will straighten up, I'll come down from heaven and offer myself for you. He said, I am going to come down and offer myself. I'm going to empty myself of my place in heaven. I'm going to walk down into your life, and I'm going to hang out with people that are sick or lonely or wandering or depressed or hopeless. He said, I'm going to spend time with all of you whose habits are overwhelming you, who's living in destruction relationships. People are, and still today, are Jesus' main focus. Read John 8 this afternoon. The woman that's caught in adultery, they throw her in the middle of a circle of men. They're wanting to stone her. They've caught her in adultery. The very act. Yet Jesus kneels down in the sand beside him. And some of us think he begins to write the sins of all those around. And then he stands up and says, the first one of you with no sin, throw that stone. And as the stones drop, Jesus kneels down and helps this woman up and says, who are there to stand? You're forgiven. Now go and sin no more. You know, it's that powerful act of a God who has made a choice to leave heaven, the glorious place there is, and to give himself up for us. See, I wonder if we are living, or if we are willing to leave behind our comfort for God. You know, the second one is to change our priorities. Listen to this, but in humility, regard others as better than yourselves. What do you value? I mean, what do you celebrate? What is it that you want? It's not your wants, your needs, your lives that really matter. If we are willing to put others ahead of ourselves, I know this is the hardest thing to do. See, I told you this, putting aside yourself or others is not easy. Basically, it is living your life through and giving your life away through service and generosity. Now, I know that you all think Chick-fil-A invented that, but they didn't. Walmart didn't either. Jesus is the one that set that example for us. As a matter of fact, Paul tells Timothy in his command, for him to command the people of Ephesus this, to do good, to be rich in good works, generosity, and ready to share so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. See, Jesus is the one that invented service. His life was totally devoted to serving those who had been sent, whom he had come to set free. You know, I read all the time these articles about businesses who do all this customer research trying to figure out their target market. We've done some of that. The truth is, I can tell you our target market. Our customers are every human being that's outside of these walls. You know, you heard me mention, I think I mentioned Odell Bennett's name last week in my sermon. Odell Bennett was an 80-year-old lady, frail lady that was about this tall, but when she said something, you said, yes, ma'am. And the first day I showed up at Lowell, she told me on that first Sunday that she'd be by at 8:00 Monday morning to take me to visit all the shut-ins. And what did I say? Yes, ma'am. Now, I did say, let me drive, not you. But we went from house to house, seeing everybody there. And you know, I didn't understand Odell's lifestyle really until I got to know her. But finally, Odell had cancer in one of her legs, and they were going to have to remove her leg. And I went over and was sitting at her kitchen table. Now, you've got to understand, in her little apartment, this lady had lost her husband in World War II, had never remarried. She just, you know, it was a kitchen table and two chairs. Very, very simplistic. You know, and I asked one of the ladies in the church, I said, why don't we help Odell more? Or she seems like we could do. She said, no, you don't understand. She said, Odell doesn't have things, not because she can't afford things, because she gives everything away. She said, I gave her a coat one time because it was cold, and you know what she did? She gave it to somebody else. Do you hear it? It's about giving ourselves away for others. You know, remember the popular thing, I am second? We saw all these athletes telling their story and saying, I am second. Well, guess what? They had it wrong. Gale Sayers got it right. Because Gale Sayers wrote his book and he said, I am third. Do you remember Gale Sayers? Great running back. Best friend, Brian Piccolo. And you know what Gale Sayers said in his autobiography? He said, God is first. Others are second, and I am third. This week, we had a devotion on Tuesday morning breakfast, and we talked about joy, and it hit me later. I don't remember who told me this, but you know the acronym for joy, don't you? You want joy in your life? It's Jesus, it's others, and then it's yourself. Your priorities. And the last one, and I admitted in the 8:30 service that I kind of struggle with this word, look for the one, which is what's supposed to be in the blank, but we're going to change it. We can do that because I left it blank. So you can change this. It's connect with the one. See, that's how God did things. That's how Jesus showed us the love of God. He didn't hold things back. He just kind of came into our life and he connected with us. And how did he do it? He connected with us by developing friendships by engaging in the lives of the people around him. And to engage in the life of someone, you got to put aside yourself and your agenda and adopt God. Well, I lived in Fayette. There was a guy that lived across the street from me. His name was Monty, and his father was in the church, and it was kind of a challenge to see if we could witness to Monty, if I could witness to Monty. So every day I would go to the mailbox. I guess my wife wishes I'd do this more. I'd go out to the mailbox, and guess what? Monty would be getting his mail, and we'd stand there and talk. We had conversation after conversation after conversation. Finally, after several months, Monty came to church, and then Monty gave his life to the Lord. And I mean, Monty got so fired up that Monty went out. His job then, he was going to convert the whole town of Fayette. He would go to Walmart every day, and he would walk up and down the aisles telling people about Jesus. And we'd still meet at the mailbox. He told me one day, he said, "I just don't understand it. People will tell me they're coming to church. They'll tell me they believe this, and then they won't do anything." He said, "I just don't, why are people that way?" I said, "Monty, whoa, chill out." I said, "Monty, let me ask you." I said, "Did I walk to the mailbox every day with my big Bible in my hand, and when you walked up to get your mail, hit you over the head with it? And then come out the next day and hit you over the head with it until I either knocked you out or till you started listening?" He said, "No." I said, "Well, that's what you're doing in Walmart." I said, "Go to Walmart and be nice to people. Connect with people. Build a relationship with these people. And then when you build that relationship with them, then it opens the door for you to invite them and to share your story, to tell them what God and Jesus has done in your life." That's what Jesus did, folks. I mean, think about it. That's how he did it when in John 4, the woman at the well, Jesus didn't walk up and hit her over the head with the Bible, did he? He started talking to her about what? Water. When Nicodemus came in the middle of the night, Jesus talked to him about rebirth and the religion that Nicodemus understood. When Zacchaeus climbed a tree to see him, Jesus said, "Zacchaeus, get down from that tree and let's go to your house and connect." Matthew, he went to the tax collector's booth. Peter, he jumped right in the boat with him. And James and John, he went to the shore and cast a net really out with them. You know, that's the way it is. Have you ever noticed that when we are connected to Jesus, then in that moment our arms get wider and we quit judging people? And we start opening up our arms and offering grace and mercy and compassion in those moments. You know, the big idea here is a Christ-like mind prioritizes the one. You know, Jason and I have put a lot of planning. Ronnie told you, we've planned and planned about this, sir. We may have overplanned these two summer series, but we've tried to make it as easy as possible for you. Because I know that we're calling you to do something different, or challenging you to do something different. To get out and talk to people and invite them to church. So we're trying our best to figure out ways to make it easy. So in the Welcome Center, there are these signs, and we're asking you to put these signs in your front yard. We've even got the stands. You don't have to do anything but put them together and stick them out in the front yard. You know, and I'm not saying that y'all got to go sit by the sign and explain them to everybody. Because you know what? This QR code right here takes them straight to a website that's the me I want to be. Tells them all about it. Our goal is September the 10th. That's the first day of this series. We want to fill this place on September the 10th. And you'll notice the sheets of paper Y'all did so good last week, I thought we'd put up another one. You probably noticed them in your Sunday school rooms. That's for you to have a place for you to invite your friends, those folks here, to help you by praying for that person that you're inviting. Don't put their whole name, just put their first name. And you know, we're going to help you a little bit more because we're going to send out 5,000 postcards that look just like this sign. What we're hoping is that some of your neighbors will get this sign, this postcard, and they'll say, hey, I've seen that sign somewhere. Let me go by and ask so-and-so about that. We're trying to make this as easy as possible for you to say, hey, why don't you come with me to church? Invite them to come and be a part of this series. So I think Jesus is inviting us to a new stage of life in this church. I think he's inviting us all to move forward and develop that Christ-like mind. You know, this morning as Ronnie comes and leads us in our closing hymn, I'll remind you this altar is open to anyone who would like to come forward and have a word of prayer. It's here. Maybe God's calling you to step out of your pew and say, hey, I don't understand all this, but I want to know more about Jesus. Well, guess what? This is your time. Or maybe your staff is just coming up here and writing a name on the sheet of paper so that others can pray with you for that moment as Ronnie leads us in song.
Take time to be holy, speak up with thy Lord, abide in him always, and feed on his word. Make friends of God's children, help those who are weak, forgetting in nothing his blessing to seek. Take time to be holy, the world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, like him thou shalt be. Thy friends and thy conduct is like this shall see.
And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.